Welcome to Nano Matters, the podcast that explores examples of nanotechnology. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Here with me today is Scott VanEpps, Assistant Professor of Emergency Medicine at the University of Michigan. So Scott, can you tell us why you use nanotechnology to fight infection?
Yeah, so I'm going to actually take us all the way back to Alexander Fleming's discovery of penicillin. He discovered penicillin. It's an antibiotic, sort of revolutionized the antiseptic era. And about two decades after that, he said that microbes become educated against penicillin, which was sort of our first understanding of antibiotic resistance. So since that time, we've made more and more antibiotics, but resistance is keeping up. In fact, we actually haven't had any real new classes of antibiotics, maybe one or two in my entire lifetime now. But antibiotic resistance is sort of continuing to come up. And so I believe that there's a role for nanotechnology to sort of fill in this sort of expanding gap between new antibiotic drugs and developing resistance. And the second area where this is in the area of medical device infection, where bacteria form a biofilm, which provides it a bit of protection, sort of a barrier to traditional antibiotics, which is different than resistance. And so new technologies are needed there as well.
So would you use the same types of strategies for fighting infection on a medical device like an implant compared with the antimicrobial resistance that you just described?
Not necessarily, actually. So we've created materials that are actually very good anti-biofilm nanoparticles, but they're not very toxic to the bacteria. So they help break up the biofilm and therefore make it more susceptible to a traditional antibiotic, versus we've created other nanoparticles which are much better antibiotics. They kill the bacteria when they're floating around, but they're not very good against biofilms. And there are ways to sort of combine those and perhaps sort of get a double-duty nanoparticle or nanomaterial as well. So there are different features that we're trying to achieve with that.
Let's back up and maybe talk a little bit about the types of medical devices that you're talking about, and then potential strategies you would use with nanotechnology to assist with that.
We are very interested in just about anything that we implant to sort of improve your life. And that be anything from as simple as a urinary catheter to a catheter they put in a vein to give you medicines, to an artificial heart valve, to a pacemaker, to a prosthetic hip, including when someone has a cataract and they replace the lens. All of those are implanted medical devices that have the potential to be infected. And the way we would think about nanotechnology here comes in two sides. The first one is creating the material that avoids the infection, prevents the bacteria from binding to it and growing on it, or kills the bacteria when it gets on it, versus a separate material that we apply to a device that's already become infected. And so we're working in both of those spaces.
If I understood correctly, it's designing the device so that the bacteria won't stick to prevent the infection, and then you also look at treatments after an infection has already taken place or is underway.
That is correct. We are interested in both processes. I have a bit of scientific skepticism that we'll ever be able to create a perfect device that is perfectly anti-infective, and so I want to have my contingent plan for how to treat it when it does get infected eventually.
So can you describe the different strategies for each of those cases?
Yeah. In the case of a preventative material, that can all then be broken up into sort of two different mechanisms. One of them is that it just prevents adhesion. It changes the chemistry in the environment such that the bacteria doesn't recognize it or can't stick to it for very long. And this can be done from a nanotechnology standpoint by alteration in the chemistry. But something that we're very interested in is actually the topography of it, right? So thinking of like the shape of the surface at the nano level. So zooming in, and bacteria are naturally at the nano level. So Staphylococcus aureus, a lot of people know about Staph aureus or MRSA, is about 600 or up to 800 nanometers in size. And so creating surfaces that have a very specific texture to them can either promote or inhibit binding. Another mechanism for this is that the entire surface can be coated with a nanoparticle that is toxic to the bacteria. So yes, they still bind. In fact, we may even want to increase binding, but when they bind, we kill them. And so what that does is prevent further growth. Those are two ways to handle the preventative mechanism there.
To prevent the bacteria from sticking, our listeners might be familiar, especially students who have explored nanotechnology a little bit, they might be familiar with hierarchical structures that create a super hydrophobic surface like the lotus leaf or other examples in nature, where the dirt will just be rinsed right off. Is that what you mean by surface treatment and structure?
Yes, I think that's a very good example of that. I actually have a graduate student who was trying to describe, and she was inspired by a cicada wing, exactly like you said, which is these arrays of nano-sized pillars. It turns out that there are certain sets of sizes of those pillars which can prevent binding, create these super hydrophobic surfaces, so to speak. Turns out that actually the bacteria like to traverse that hydrophilic to hydrophobic space. And so you may prevent the dirt from getting on it, but the bacteria will swim into that space. Also, there are certain surfaces that the bacteria really like, and it's like the perfect size for them to fit into or for their little flagella that they use to swim with to sort of wrap around these. We've also seen in places where the bacteria climb in and grab a hold of these pillars and pull them on top of themselves as almost like a protector. And so finding the right set of dimensions, both in the size of the pillar, how far apart they are, how many of them there are, how tall they are they pointed on the top, are they flat on the top? There's so many variables that we're trying to sort out. And when you look at a biomimetic concept like a cicada wing or a lotus leaf, it turns out that there are many different regimes on that same wing. And so we're trying to find the best combinations to try to sort that out. And we're building structures that allow us to test them very rigorously like a scientist. We test each individual variable separately to find the optimum set of materials.
So that was a discussion of preventing the bacteria from getting on the surface. Now, if you have a bacterial film on a surface, what types of strategies do you use to get rid of that biofilm?
So biofilms are very interesting and I think maybe sort of underappreciated. Essentially what a biofilm is, it's a community of bacteria that are attached to a surface typically, and they've created an extracellular matrix. They've created proteins and DNA and sugars. It's like a gel that holds all the bacteria in place and it provides essentially protection. It's like being behind the walls of a castle in sort of medieval times. And there's sort of three protective levels from that. The first one is that it just prevents the antibiotics from diffusing it. The second one is that all the bacteria are sort of slow growing and quiet. Because of that, even if the antibiotic gets in, the target that that antibiotic is going after within the bacteria isn't present or is in very low amounts. And so even though the antibiotic gets in, it has to be in a concentration 1,000 times more than, say, it would normally need to do to kill the bacteria. And the last thing it does is this helps you evade the immune system. So what happens is the immune system attacks this, and eventually you kill the white blood cells rather than killing the bacteria. And then that lays down another layer of protection as sort of the pieces, the debris from killing the white blood cells. And so one of the things that we've targeted with Staphylococcus aureus biofilms is they make a peptide, which under the right circumstances turns into an amyloid fiber. And it's one of the things that really strengthens this biofilm, makes it very mature, very hard to get rid of. Most of the chemical treatments can't get rid of it completely. And we have found a graphene quantum dot, so a small, about 4 nanometer, tiny little sheet of carbon, essentially, that we can use, and it targets that peptide. It prevents the peptide from forming the amyloid. But more importantly, it actually, when it binds to the amyloid, after it's already formed, it helps disassemble it, makes that biofilm easier to sort of lift off of the surface, remove the cells from the surface, so we can kill them with a traditional antibiotic without that super high 1,000-fold concentration that was needed when it was packed into the biofilm.
So we discussed this in the context of medical devices and implants. Do you see this type of strategy working in biofilms that might be in other areas of the hospital? I mean, we hear of, you mentioned MRSA outbreaks at a hospital and that it's very difficult to control. Will this strategy help in those situations?
Yeah, absolutely. It's very challenging, actually, to come up with a material you can put in the body, because not only do you have to kill the bacteria and deal with that, but you actually have to not be toxic to the human cells and not cause any problems there. A sort of intermediate place to work and apply some of these technologies in places that aren't implanted in the surface. And I think of high contact surfaces, the things that we've all, during the current pandemic, have been worried about, touching doorknobs and sort of things we all come into contact with on a daily basis. In the hospital, that could be the bedside table, or the rails alongside the bed, or the handles on the sink, things that we bring in and out of the room, like my stethoscope that I wear around my neck or in my pocket, or the EKG machine that comes in and they attach and then they take off and they go in the next room. These are other places where I think this technology could be rapidly applied.
So you mentioned at the outset, antimicrobial resistance, and we know that that is a challenge. How are you using nanotechnology? And we're not talking about the surface films now, but talking about the broader issue of antimicrobial resistance. How do nanotechnology strategies assist in that case?
Yeah, so as I said in the beginning, the number of new antibiotics that have come out over the last couple of decades have been decreasing. The pipeline is sort of drying up, so to speak. But the amount of resistant bacteria has been increasing as a function of time. And they're projecting that up to 10 million deaths in 2050 from antibiotic-resistant bacteria alone. It's one of those problems that we see a little bit now, right? But if the trend continues, it could be real high. And so the mechanism for finding new antibiotics currently is we have a huge database of chemicals that we use, small molecule chemicals that have been found in nature. Most of our antibiotics are based on chemicals we found in nature, like penicillin. And we've really tapped that well a lot to get the antibiotics we currently have. And it's getting drier and drier. And we don't really have a good new substrate. And I believe that nanoparticles are the substrate that we can tap into. And the beauty of this is that most of the bacteria have never seen them. And so the ability to develop resistance is going to be lower. But even better than that is because nanoparticles are actually quite a bit bigger than a small molecule like penicillin or streptomycin. It's quite a bit bigger than that. And it actually allows it to kill the bacteria from a couple of different directions. So if it develops resistance here, there's the other option. And those two things, I think, are what make nanotechnology for this purpose perfect as a new substrate and sort of resource for us to develop new drugs, specifically for antibiotics.
So what types of materials are you exploring? And would it be like a pill you swallow like you do now for an antibiotic?
It certainly could be. We're very interested in many mechanisms or many applications for nanoparticles. We've been working very closely with carbon-based materials like graphene, but we've also done a lot of work with metals and metal oxides. I think a lot of people have heard of silver being a material that's got some antibacterial properties. And it was actually even used in medical devices because of that. Turns out it's not as effective as we would like, and it's got some toxicity issues. But we've worked with another material, zinc oxide. And in fact, you'll actually see zinc oxide in a lot of cosmetic products because of some antibacterial properties. It's also good sunscreen. So we've done a lot of work with zinc oxide being a very good material for this purpose. But we've actually expanded this into many other materials. Cerium oxide is a new one, titanium dioxide, as well as sort of more organic chemistry-based nanotechnology.
Where do you envision it going in the future? I mean, do you envision your work expanding into new areas?
Oh, absolutely. My heart's in for healthcare. I take care of patients. I see them in the emergency department. And that's sort of where my focus tends to go. But the concept of biofilms, bacteria, I mean, they're everywhere. I like to remind folks that there are actually 10 times as many bacterial cells in their body currently than their own cells. And that's sort of hard to wrap your brain around, but bacteria are here and we are living with them and we want to live with them. We don't want to actually eradicate them. And I think many people have heard of the microbiome, sort of the benefits of the bacteria that live in your gut and in your mouth and on your skin. And those are all good things. But there are other sort of huge applications for this. So there's a lot of work in wastewater treatment. This sort of touches on things that I do because of the health benefits, but there's a lot of work in using bacterial biofilms to help clean water. And how do you maintain that? And so there may be value to sort of balancing what I'm trying to do, which is sort of eradicate and kill bacteria, to promoting maybe good bacteria for a particular purpose. There's a lot of work. I think it's been estimated that there's a lot of money lost in fuel on the Navy on biofilms that grow on the side of the ship. It reduces the hydrodynamics of the boat. And so coming up with mechanisms to reduce the drag associated with that is sort of an entirely different application. And then recently I've read about the biodiesel fuel, where there's all these bacteria that actually live and grow on the biodiesel fuel and foul it and prevent it from working when you want to put it in the truck or the material or the vehicle that you're using. And so I think the applications for this sort of extend well beyond healthcare and finding the balance between the good and the bad bacteria. They're here to stay. We're going to be with them. It's how do we do that in a way that sort of helps us to live better and sort of continue doing what we're doing.
This has been a lot of fun. I've really enjoyed learning about your research and where it can be applied. Do you have any advice for students that might be listening and have an interest in this area, or just advice broadly?
What I would say is that these are problems that aren't tackled by one person like me sitting in my lab all by myself. These are problems that require people from all disciplines. We need folks in healthcare taking care of these patients and helping me build the medical trials for the new device that I created. We need folks in chemistry who are coming up with new ways to make these materials that is safe and easy and can make lots of it for all the different ones that we want. We need folks in mechanical engineering to help us build the materials so that they create the structure that we want for the device that we want. We need pharmacists that'll help us with all of the work and making sure it gets to where we want it to go and then gets cleared by the kidneys or the liver and those kinds of things. And it quickly expands to, you know, folks in civil and environmental engineering for, say, wastewater treatment, or folks in marine engineering. So what I would say is, no matter what your interest is in, you will probably start to touch on this area of nanotechnology. And so you don't have to be a microbiologist to have interest in this area, and you don't have to be an engineer, you don't have to be a physician. Wherever your interests are, you're going to touch on this space. And so we welcome whatever your expertise is and bring it to this problem.
Well, that's great. And thank you again for being here with us today. Do you have any closing thoughts that you'd like to share?
Just thank you very much for having me. I'm quite passionate about this, as you might be able to tell, and I very much enjoy it. And for all those who are out there interested in science and these things, just keep your interest up and keep asking questions.